is the fear of not knowing and committing some mistake, which will lead to some kind of liability when we don't know everything or anything which is perfect. And that is another important point. So whenever the legal aspect comes, people talk of liabilities. And I'm extremely happy and over guideline comes, there is a challenge. Whether this guideline is just a guideline, which is a self-regulation, or it is a legally binding guideline. So I'll just touch upon two or three important parts from legal perspective, whether what exactly the legal perspective of these telemedicine guidelines which are released in March. And when you have some guidelines, there would be some kind of best practices that would be recommended in guidelines. And when you talk about best practices, what comes the do's and don'ts? And when you think of don'ts, the most important thing which will come into telemedicine guidelines is you are sitting on a huge data. And the data is going to be a medical record, which is a sensitive information which I'll touch upon. So let me firstly touch upon the legal aspect. Most important point we need to understand on these particular guidelines which are released by Board of Governors on Supervision of Medical Council of India along with Niti Aayog and released by Ministry of Health is applicable to registered medical practitioners, which are allopathic doctors. This particular guideline does not cover other doctors like Ayush. However, Ayurveda Council and Homeopathic Councils and Siddha Councils have come out with their own guidelines, which is on the similar line, which is also applicable when you tell me this great initiative or a great start by the government allow telemedicine activities. The second point is binding nature. Yes, this telemedicine guideline is binding because it is coming under Indian Medical Council Act. However, this is binding to the registered medical practitioners, which are allopathic doctors who are registered with Medical Council of India and respective states. Now the challenge that is really happening here is, what does it cover? It is giving excellent guidance right from what are the modalities to use, what should be done, what should not be done. But there are certain important points I will highlight when it comes to telemedicine. It is binding for doctors, but the challenge is it does not cover any other stakeholder, because telemedicine is not just doctor. Telemedicine would require some kind of a technology platform, some kind of a bandwidth requirement. There could be a telemedicine center, there could be a software provider, there would be hardware provider. So I will just quickly read upon one particular thing which I think from law perspective it is very important for all of us to understand, and we are going to discuss how exactly this can be taken. This guideline has a specific exclusions which are very relevant from law perspective. The exclusions I will just read out. The guideline specifically explicitly exclude the following: specification for hardware or software, infrastructure, building and maintenance, data management systems involved, standards and interoperability, use of digital technology to conduct surgical and invasive procedures remotely, other aspects of telehealth such as research and evaluation of continuing education of health and healthcare workers, and does not provide for consultation outside the jurisdiction of India. So these are very important point from law point of view, that these are the four or five important factors which are explicitly excluded. So anybody, any doctor or a service provider who is tying up with hospitals or doctors and providing such services, they need to be aware of this purely from law, because liability can arise. If there is a foreign doctor advising Indian patient, then this particular, it will be a kind of a breach. It will be a breach on part of the person who is performing this particular service. So broadly, these are the legal aspects. Quickly, it covers only allopathic doctors and is legally binding in the Indian Medical Council Act, period. Now, it also gives some important best practices which needs to follow. But what I think need to understand is what type of communications you need to use. That is number one. Number two, what type of data you will capture, generate, save, store, and transmit. That is also important. The guidelines have also categorized various medications into various lists, like list A, B, O, and there is a prohibited list also. There are certain drugs which cannot be prescribed. And the third and most important point, they will say, what you are talking, saying, you must cover. So purely on do's and don'ts, most important thing is that you need to follow the recommendations which are there in the guideline. I don't want to enumerate everything for the want of time. But it is very important for the person who is using this or being used by somebody else. Please be watchful on type of drug you are prescribing. Number two, what modality you are using, whether it is falling within the guidelines. And it is most important point here is that please ensure that the identity and the basic details and the history of patient is taken down and recorded. And the most important thing, don't be under that impression that, hey, I'm doing things online. There is no need to document everything. Please, 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 being a lawyer, I would say to doctor in me, please document. This is the biggest problem I think the medical fraternity had. I hated documentation for 15 years. I realized the importance of documentation on 16th year when became a lawyer. And the most important point is that data privacy norms need to be followed. And why these and don'ts are important? Because guidelines very specifically mention that this is, though it is binding, but all other prevailing laws which touch upon this kind of services would be applicable. There's a data privacy laws would be applicable. Prescription things would be applicable. Drugs and Cosmetic Act would be applicable as and when it touches. However, the good part is the guidelines has provided format of prescriptions. We are going to touch upon how exactly the consents need to be taken. If patient is initiating, then implied consent is fine. But if as a doctor you are initiating the entire telemedicine consultation, there is a need for express consent also. So broadly, these are the things I think you need to cover. So to sum up what I said, I think I would just like to end by saying very important point that whether you love law or hate law, you just can't ignore law. And I'm reminded of my favorite statement by Michael Kirby of Medical Technology and Frontiers of Family Law. He once said that the hair of science and technology lurches ahead. The hair of science and technology always lurches ahead. The tortoise of the law ambles slowly behind. I'm very happy that we have these guidelines. We'll answer your questions. But what I'm trying to say, in 2 days' time, especially when we are you going to use telemedicine to the fullest, no hair is going to sleep. So that tortoise can, at a slow and steady pace, can win the place. You have to develop that attitude of tortoise with the speed of hair to develop that particular best practices to become a winner. Over to you, Professor Supten.
Thank you, Dr. Menon, for being so lucid as usual. We'll come back to you with the questions. Already we're having questions in the chat box. I'll now invite Mr. Bharat Gera. It's your turn for the opening remarks. Over to you, Bharat.
Hi, Mr. Bharat, you are on mute.
Sorry, I didn't realize I was still on mute. So I'm going to start from where Dr. Milan left. And he rightly said, you know, that technology surges ahead of law and, you know, things start happening and the law has to catch up when technology moves ahead. Now, telemedicine has been around for longer. It has been, been there for quite some time now. With the, if you look at telemedicine, there are basically three broad categories. And if you look at how it is delivered, it started off essentially with telemedicine for access to places that were remote, and in India. It started with the ISRO satellites providing telemedicine services to remote locations. Then there is the next stage in the telemedicine. There is several apps that have come up which allow you to consult a doctor online. But even before that, if you think of yourself as a patient, several follow-ups with your private hospitals, you often do on phone, chat. Since everybody has WhatsApp, a lot of people consult their doctor on WhatsApp already. When you talk to doctors, they'll tell you that 15-20% of their patients are reaching out to them on the phone, on the chats and email. What has happened now is that something that was already being done in practice has gone legal. Now, when it goes legal, there's also an implication that how do we make it a more legit service? So there has to be a business model around it, because when you say that you're just going to let your patients whom you treated for a surgery, for example, I did that for my mom, and I contacted the doctor and he gave me certain replies about follow-up medicines and also in the exercises she had to do. We do that all the time. Now, the problem for the doctors has always been, how do we monetize this? And the business models for monetization have emerged from the category of healthcare we call consumer health. So basically, if you look at the categories that are available for healthcare, I'd broadly say there's public health, which mainly is done by the government. Then there is private healthcare, which is all the hospitals, doctors, clinics, and so on. And there's consumer health, which is largely done by technology companies. So technology companies have now started providing a viable business model for charging patients for the teleconsultation. Otherwise, it was more like an add-on benefit that the healthcare provider gave to you. Now, what does that mean for the other people who have, are private healthcare players? They're scrambling. They're saying, how do we now make a service, which is, except of, leading players who already had their digital practices in place, the others are scrambling to see, how do we now provide this teleconsultation service on a paid basis? How do we allow people to take an appointment for a teleconsultation service? Will we be able to do prescriptions now that the law is allowing us to do it? Now, see, the private healthcare was more cautious about doing things on a teleplatform. They were, in the absence of a telemedicine practice guideline, they were doing it conservatively, whereas the consumer tech companies were doing it more aggressively. Now, they have suddenly had to react in a very short time on how do we monetize this. Now, when they monetize it, they have to keep their existing relationship with the patient, which is a trusted relationship. And it's difficult for them to say, yesterday you could ask me a question on WhatsApp, but today if you ask me, you have to do it through a teleconsultation. So they're having quite a few challenges about putting a business model in place. The hospitals have been the slowest to adopt this comparatively. The individual practitioners had already got onto some of these technology platforms and started providing online consultations on a paid basis. And it's easier for them to do it, because for them, the business model is just jump onto one of these platforms, register yourself, be discovered, and provide the consultation. The hospitals have a little bit more challenge, because now they have to arrange what's called a virtual OPD. And it's a whole new thing to do, where they have to now shift their regular calendars onto a technology platform. They have to link their backend systems the hospital information systems to this. They have to work out the workflow so that let's imagine a patient who's coming back for consultation after a surgery, or let's take a chronic patient who's coming to the hospital. So these are not first-time consultations. These are sometimes cases with a long history. For example, I was contacted by a patient who was had the history of neurological problems, and they wanted to get in touch with my previous hospital where I worked. And they wanted to know how they could do it on a teleconsultation. Now, it was a challenge, because there's a whole file which has to be uploaded. There are x-rays, there are scans, and the technology available right now is not perfectly suited to have a seamless experience between all the backend platforms available in the hospital. So work has to go into that. A lot of work is being done at a very rapid pace.